Good morning and a very warm welcome to St Michael and All Angels here in Springford, and also to anybody who might be watching online either now or later. It's lovely that we can be together. As we begin, I have to remind you once again that we can't sing in church yet, but we do have St Martin's in the Field choral scholars to sing for us, and you have the words to reflect on. But those of you that are at home can sing along with gusto. Everything you need is in your service book. May we begin. God is spirit.
And let us worship him in spirit and truth.
The Lord is with us.
And let us praise his name together.
And so with grateful thanks to the choral scholars of St. Martin's in the Field, our first hymn is O Worship the King.
Through weakness, through our own deliberate fault.
We
His Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Collect for the Third Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin, and have sent the Spirit of your Son into our hearts, whereby we call you Father. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that we and all creation may be brought to the glorious liberty of the children of God. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our first reading can be read by Jude. The first reading is from the book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 to 11. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness? When I fixed limits for it, and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come, and no farther, here is where your proud way is fought." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You stand if you are able to put our gospel in. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you.
That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so this was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the winds died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And John is going to come and preach us. Thank you, John.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
I've long felt an identification with the Belfast boy C.S. Lewis, whose early years were spent in Little Lee, a lovely house near to our home in East Belfast, where Joan and I lived for some 35 years. Now I have, like him, come to live in Oxfordshire and spend some of my time the university as he did. One of Lewis's most famous books was The Problem of Pain, in which he dealt with perhaps the most challenging issue for anyone seeking a moral meaning for our universe. It is the problem of the Book of Job, the apparent contradiction between a good and powerful God and the suffering of the innocent. In a letter written on the 6th of July 1949 to Arthur Greaves, his boyhood friend back in Belfast and with whom he kept in touch all through his life, Lewis said this: "I do not hold that God sends sickness or war in the sense in which he sends us all good things. Hence, in Luke 13 and 6, our Lord clearly attributes a disease not to the action of his Father, but to that of Satan. All suffering arises from sin. The sense in which it is also God's will seems to me twofold. A, the one that you mentioned, that God willed the free will of man and of angels in spite of his knowledge that it could lead in some cases to sin and thence to suffering. He thought freedom was worth creating, even at that price. It's like when a mother allows a small child to walk on its own rather than holding it by her hand. She knows it may fall, but learning to walk on one's own is worth a few falls. When it does fall, it is, in one sense, contrary to the mother's will. But the general situation in which falls are possible is the mother's will. In fact, as you and I have often said before, in one way it is, in another way it isn't. The world also is made so that sins of one inflict suffering on another. And the supreme case of this is the suffering that our sins entailed on Christ. When Christ saw that suffering drawing near, he prayed, "If thou be willing, remove this cup from me, nevertheless, not my will, but thine." This seems to me, says Lewis, to make it quite clear that crucifixion was, in the qualified sense, which I've tried to define, God's will. John Peters, in his book, C.S. Lewis, The Man and His Achievement, quotes this letter and says, "Lewis recognizes that there is no easy solution to the problem of pain, and that no intellectual solution or formula can do away with the need for patience, fortitude, and courage." And this, in essence, is the message of the Book of Job, from which we have just read. We are meaning-seeking creatures. In every circumstance of life, we try to piece things together so as to make some sense of them. We want to understand what's going on. And when bad things happen to someone else, our first thought is usually, whose fault is this? If something goes wrong for any of us, we may well jump to the conclusion that it's a result of something we ourselves have done, and on many occasions that may well be right. We may well have done something unwise. However, at other times, it's not the case. And the story of Job is of a good man who suddenly finds everything going terribly wrong in his life for no obvious reason. He's doing his best to live a good life and obey the Lord. When one day he loses all his many possessions, and on the same day his children, 7 sons and 3 daughters, are all killed in one single dreadful calamity. What is Job's reaction? "Naked I came from the womb, naked I shall return whence I came. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Shortly afterwards, he begins to suffer terrible running sores all over his body, and his wife tells him to curse God and die. Well, he does not follow her advice, but he does begin to wish he'd never been born. And naturally, he asks himself, "Why is all of this happening to me?" He's then visited by 3 friends, who respond much as the disciples did in John chapter 9, verse 2, when you will remember they ask about the man born blind. "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents? Why was he born blind?" they said. Jesus made it clear he did not believe that either the man or his parents were to blame, but this was a God-given opportunity to relieve the suffering of an innocent man. Job's 3 friends had the same mistaken view of life as the disciples. Eliphaz, the Temanite, tells Job that God is using these terrible experiences to correct him, and if he accepts this discipline, all will be well in the end. But this is no comfort to poor Job, who prays for death to take him out of his misery. Bildad, the Shuhite, his 2nd friend, insists that either he or his family must have sinned to be sent this punishment. But Job insists that while he's not perfect, his suffering is out of all proportion to anything he might have done wrong. Zophar, the Naamathite, the 3rd friend, says, "God will put things right if Job puts aside his wickedness." And Job asks him what wickedness he's committed. Job was a good man. In Ezekiel 14:14, Job is one of the 3 men whose individual righteousness is remarked upon. The other 2 were Noah and Daniel. He was right to dismiss the explanations given by these three friends. We call them, others like them, Job's comforters, rather ironically, because in fact they gave him no comfort at all, and they were profoundly mistaken as to the reason for Job's suffering. When they were finished, the young man, Elihu, also attacked Job, reiterating all the previous arguments in some thoroughly caustic words of criticism and blame, neither showing respect or sympathy for the older man. Meantime, in chapter 10, Job has been pleading with God for an explanation. And God responds in the words of our reading today from chapter 38. Speaking out of the storm, God thunders at Job, asking him, "Who does he think he is? Can you measure the boundaries of the universe? Were you around when creation came into existence? Have you ever called up the dawn or walked in the unfathomable deep?" In poetic language, God points out in no uncertain terms how limited Job is as a human being in his power, knowledge, and understanding. Job accepts the reproof with humility, and God responds that he is a just God, but he is the Almighty, and he uses the picture of a powerful and frightening beast to describe how fearful he should be to the proud and the wicked. Job's contrite response acknowledges the power of God, and he says, "I have spoken of great things which I have not understood, things too wonderful for me to know. I knew of thee then only by report, but now I see thee with my own eyes. Therefore I melt away, I repent in dust and ashes." Job bore his suffering with great fortitude and courage, and with remarkable patience. In the New Testament book of James, written hundreds of years later, we are told in chapter 5 not to blame each other for our troubles, but to follow the example of Job in his pattern of patience under ill treatment, as the New English Bible translation puts it. Job stood firm in times of trouble. However, this does not help us much in our search for meaning in the problem of suffering. The book of Job started with a rather anthropomorphic story of Satan teasing God about whether Job is only faithful to him because Job prospers him. The story then has God permitting Satan to take away all Job's cattle, family, and his health, but Job remains steadfast, and at the end of the book, God restores him to even greater wealth than before. In fact, if you read first and then at the end, he has exactly twice as many animals, and 7 new sons, and 3 daughters, even more beautiful than those he had lost. But this outcome does not explain why it was justifiable for Job to suffer so terribly, and perhaps more importantly, we know that for many people, such a happy ending is not the story of their lives. Many of the Hebrews of Job's day believed that life simply ended as it did for the grass that withers and the flower that fades. Others believed that our spirits continued in a kind of shadow existence in Sheol, a place of darkness. It was partly to answer the unanswered paradox of the justice of God and the suffering of the innocent that the idea of heaven and hell developed later. If in this life all the rights and wrongs were not resolved, then in the next life the good would be rewarded with the bliss of heaven and the wicked would be eternally punished. This did, however, leave the question of who God would regard as good. In a gospel reading from Mark chapter 4, we read that the disciples are in a boat with Jesus when it is caught in a storm, and while Jesus sleeps, they are frightened. They wake him up and scold him. "Do you not care that we're in danger of drowning?" they say. He rebukes them for their cowardice and lack of faith. And the disciples' memory of the event was that Jesus spoke and the wind and the waves calmed down. However, they seem to pay less attention to what Jesus said to them about their lack of faith and courage, rather than the miraculous response of the elements to the words of Jesus. Similarly, earlier in the same chapter, where Jesus had been speaking to the crowds in parables, he tried afterwards to explain to the disciples what he meant. And it is clear he was very frustrated by their inability to grasp the essence of his message. It does seem to me at times that this is still the case. Like the disciples, we often focus on that which is beyond our comprehension instead of following Jesus' example in how to actually live our lives. Jesus never developed a systematic theology. That all came later when men tried to fit the extraordinary, almost incomprehensible actions of God into theories that made sense to them, and then declare heretics anybody that didn't believe their explanations. Jesus trusted God and told stories that showed how people should live their lives and conduct their relationships. Whether or not we understand any better than Job why suffering comes upon the innocent, we should be doing what we can to ameliorate the suffering of the innocent, as Jesus did in John chapter 9 with the blind man who he healed. The church, as it grew and developed, increasingly insisted that people should believe in their explanations of what God was doing, declare their loyalty to those explanations, and observe the religious practices that they ordained. The reformers spoke out against some of these explanations, and especially against corrupt practices that promised people everlasting life if they observed the correct ritual and gave money to the church. However, things then went to the other extreme, and many Protestants came to believe that it was all about what you believed and not how you behaved. But this was not what Jesus said at all. He pointed constantly to a gospel of love in our relationships. God created human beings that will always try to find meaning and make sense of our world. But ultimately, I do not think that God calls on us to just believe the right things. These beliefs will change from culture to culture and with the passage of time. But in all times and in all places, we are called to live lives of humility, love, and concern for others. Lives lived in the imitation of the timeless example of Christ. He is the ultimate example for us of the suffering of the innocent who remains steadfast to the end. Amen. And God will bless us to our hearts.
Stand if you are able to, as we declare our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Jesus Christ, Saviour and Prince of Peace, still us, O Lord, as you stilled the storm. Calm us, O Lord, and keep us from harm. Let all the troubles within us cease. Enfold us, Lord, in your deep peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the earth and sea, protect all who work upon the seas, all fishermen and seafaring people. We pray for our Royal Navy and the Merchant Navy, for those who man lifeboats and work on oil rigs. We pray for all across the world whose lives are endangered by storms and floods. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all who provide our food, all who protect us and shield us from harm. We pray today for our own homes and loved ones. And we pray for all who are vulnerable to losing their homes due to changes in circumstance, due to the pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of all power, facing storms of life, all who are facing hardship and danger, those having sleepless nights, those exhausted, and those who today will go hungry. We pray for all who are fearful and anxious, that they may know your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all who have passed through life's storms and are now at peace in your presence. And we pray for all the loved ones departed and for all who grieve. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ came and proclaimed the gospel. Peace to those who are far off, and peace to those who are near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And so we acknowledge one another with a nod or a wave. As you know, the common cup is currently suspended and you will be receiving the bread. We will come to you, which will precede me with the hand gel. So if you would like to receive communion, if you could stand with your hands raised. And if you would like a blessing, please stand and just keep your hands down. But first, our next hymn, thanks to the choral scholars of St. Martin's in the Field, Timeless Love, we sing the story. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is in us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to our Lord God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to him, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love. And unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. And let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body. Because we all share in my bread.
The body and blood of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
We pray together, pray for spiritual communion for those at home. Lord Jesus, we believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. We love you above all things, and we desire to receive you into ourselves. For those of us that cannot at this moment receive you sacramented, come spiritually into our hearts. May we embrace you as if you were already there, and unite ourselves wholly to you. Never permit us to be separated from you. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory. You are three persons, yet one God, now and forever. Amen. Pray together. Fill us, good Lord, with your Spirit of love. And as you have fed us with the one bread of heaven, so make us one in heart and mind, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Let us go in peace to love and